Hello everyone, Professor Poepping here. Here we will look at an example where the acceleration is in the opposite direction to the velocity. Two important points here. First, if we define motion to be in the positive direction, this then means a negative acceleration, but we could equally well switch these two. Second, because the acceleration specifically is acting opposite to the velocity, it means a deceleration, as we will see. So the example reads, in a game of curling, a rock is sent along the ice where it experiences a constant acceleration of 26 centimeters per second squared in a direction opposite to the initial velocity. The rock travels 28 meters from release before coming to rest. Determine the rock's initial velocity and travel time. So you'll see from the diagram, we've already shown we've got a schematic showing the parameters of interest. We've got a velocity that's to the right, where we've defined this as our positive direction to the right. We start with a position that we're going to define as zero, and then we're going to travel 28 meters from there. It tells us that it's got an acceleration that's opposite direction of the velocity. So it's a negative 26 centimeters per second squared. It's negative because we've defined positive in this direction, and it's going in the opposite direction. So it's going in the negative direction. And that means it's going to slow down until it comes to a final velocity of 0 meters per second. In other words, it stops. Let's identify the unknown and known quantities here. And we'll pull them out like we did before in a sort of table format or column format. T naught is zero. X naught is also zero because we've defined it that way. And our V naught is unknown. But we do know that we've got an acceleration of negative 26 centimeters per second squared. At a time, later time t, that we don't know, we've got a position of positive 28 meters, a velocity that is zero because it's at rest. And so again, we'll start by plotting it out to have a look at this. We should recognize again that it's a constant acceleration problem. The acceleration's in a negative direction, and so it tells us that it's a negative slope. So we're starting out with some initial velocity, and we have a negative slope like this, going from V naught of some value down to a V equal to zero at this later time. And so you'll notice that we have a negative constant slope, and this is our negative acceleration, or due to our negative acceleration. So that's our velocity plot. What about our position plot as a function of time? We're starting out with a position of zero, and we're going to end up with a position of 28. But what are we doing now? We're starting out with something that has a higher positive slope and going until we have a zero slope. So we're starting out steep and tapering off until we have a zero slope. And that zero slope means that we've come to rest at this point t. And we started out with an x naught equal to zero, and we're going until a position of 28 meters. And a slope or in other words a velocity equal to zero. what are we trying to solve for now? The first thing it asks us is to solve for the initial velocity. Well, time is unknown. Our total time is unknown, but our delta x is known. So again, it suggests that we want to look at something that doesn't involve the time, but does involve the displacement. And number two, we're asked for the travel time. So the t that is unknown here, but now I will know both of my velocities because I've solved for the initial velocity up above, and I know my acceleration, and so I'll be able to then use this equation to solve for my time. Okay, I'm going to carry those forward onto the next page so that we have some space to work out the problem. Here first, we're solving for the initial velocity, and we already recognized that we can use the equation involving velocities and positions. We'll take a little inventory. What do we know? We know that our initial position is zero. We know what our acceleration is. We know our final position. We know our final velocity because it's also zero, and we're trying to solve for V naught. Let's rearrange it so that we can do just that. So V naught squared is equal to a negative 2ax, and that means then that V naught is going to be equal to plus or minus, so I'm going to be taking a square root. And either of them could potentially be the answer that I want. And so when we put those values in, we've got 2 times the acceleration, which I was told was positive 26 centimeters per second squared. But I didn't do it earlier, and I'll do it now. I want to convert that to meters, so I've got 1 meter per 10 to the 2 centimeters. And I'm going to leave my displacement then as 28 meters, already in meter units of meters. What I get out of that is a positive negative 3.815 meters per second. And based on the plot that I showed earlier, I then know that, in fact, the answer I really want is that positive value. So 3.8 meters per second once I use the correct significant digits. Number two was to solve for the time at which it comes to rest. And we identified this as our useful equation, V equal to V naught plus AT, where again, I can take a little inventory. This is zero. This I now know from up above, the V naught I know from up above, the acceleration I know, and time is what I'm trying to solve for. So let's rearrange and solve for t. So I've got 0 minus that positive velocity from up above, 3.815 meters per second, and an acceleration of negative 0.26 meters per second squared. And very important to recognize that it needs to be that negative acceleration here, or you'll get a different answer, obviously by the sign, and identifying that generally we're dealing with a positive time because we've defined the start of our problem at t equal to zero. So we get here now a positive time, 14.67 seconds, and once I put that into correct significant digits, I've got a positive 15 seconds.